strikes me that I can't think of a better place, a better space to be reading poetry than this one. I don't think I've found a space like this in a very, very long time. And now I'm suddenly filled with regret that I'm not just doing another kind of session altogether. And maybe I will turn this into the kind of session I want this to be, which is an excuse to just share poems, because poets yearn for this kind of intimacy and this kind of mic. When it actually all comes together, it just feels like the ideal scenario. So thank you all for being here, and thank you, Samira. When God is a Traveller is the title of the most recent book of poems. And whenever I look back on this book, which is just was released last year, I realize that there's been a substantial shift in some ways from the earlier work. And in other ways, it's remained pretty much the same. So what I'd like to do with you today, if that's all right, is to read poems, share poems with you. Essentially, this is a pretext to read poems. But I'd also like to give you a sense of what some of this journey has meant. We talked about co-travelers. When God is a Traveler is really about claiming for oneself the ideal traveler, the ideal fellow traveler. But when I look back, and go back to my very first book of poems, which happened in 2001, I realized that the notion of the journey has been significant in one way or the other from the very beginning. The geographical journey, the metaphorical journey, the mundane journey, the magical journey, some very literal journey, and some a little less literal. So I'd like to offer you a glimpse of some of the earlier poems and gradually lead into this. Say that this is such a terrific space that I'm just reluctant to not make use of it in some way. I just want to say, please do feel free. Periodically, I'll just stop. And if there are those of you who'd like to, I don't know, intervene in some way, whether it's in terms of a question, an observation, anything that you'd like to share, please do. That would be ideal, really, in a space like this. And I've also got a couple, I'd actually like to start with a poem from my very first book, which feels now like a very long time ago. The book happened in 2001. This poem was written a long time before that. But in a space like this, in Bombay, it feels absolutely right to read it, because it's an experience each one of us here has had in some way or the other. It's the absolutely matchless experience of traveling in a peak hour Bombay local. 5:46 Andheri local. In the women's compartment of a Bombay local, we search for no personal epiphanies, like metal licked by relentless acetylene. We are welded. Dreams, disasters, germs, destinies, flesh and organza, odors and ovaries, a thousand-limbed, million-tongued, multi-spoused Kali on wheels. When I descend, I could choose to dice carrots or a lover. I postpone the latter.
Wow. Wow.
Thankfully, I have stopped traveling by the way. It's good for the carrots. And good for some other people as well. That's one kind of journey that it just felt right to start with. In the recent past, I've been doing a lot of readings from my Bombay poems. But since we're all right here in Bombay, I'm going to postpone the other Bombay poems for a bit. Though I did promise, I think, Tripti that I would read a poem called Where I Live, which is really about being in the city. But today, on my way here, I decided I would be perverse and and read another kind of travel poem, another kind of place poem. This is...
I was neither born nor bred here, but I know this city of casuarina and tart mango slices, gritty with salt and chili and the truant sands of the marina. The powdered grey jowls of film heroes, my mother's sari, hectic with moonlight, still crackling with the voltage of an N.D. Ramanathan concert. The flickering spice root of tamarind and onion from Mylapore homes on summer evenings. The vast opera of the Bay of Bengal flambéed with sun. And a language as intimate as the taste of sarsaparilla pickle, the recipe lost, the sour cadences as comforting as home. It's no use. Cities ratify their connections with you when you're looking the other way, annexing you through summer holidays, through osmotic memories of your father's glib lie to a kindergarten teacher. My mother is the fair one. And the taste of coffee one day in Lucca, suddenly awakening an old prescription. Beebery, plantation A, and 50 grams of chicory from the fragrant shop near the Kapalishwara temple. City that creeps up on me just when I'm about to affirm world citizenship. I think I knew I had that particular book ready. This was a book called Where I Live, which was my previous collection. I knew that collection was ready when I found that the poems collectively seemed to be trying to address the gap between where I live and where I belong. With the new book, I always say, I'm not quite sure where I live anymore, but I think there's a deeper sense of belonging, and that permeates the poems in some way. But this is an ironic poem, which I think I'd like to do before we move into another kind of tone. This is a poem on a city that you all know, maybe most of you have visited, I'm not sure. Banaras? How many? Almost everyone. Okay. Which is, I always say my Bombay poems are particularly ambivalent, and it's difficult not to be ambivalent about Banaras. It's a city that fills you with revulsion and with fascination all at once. Banaras. It has an epigraph, which is a wonderful signboard that I found on Kedar Ghat, which went Moonlight English Coaching Center, O label to standard label, spelled L-E-B-A-L. Intended, of course, to be level, but I thought it was a delicious sign, so of course I took a photograph when I went there for the very first time in 2009. And eventually the signboard worked its way into a poem. So there's the epigraph. Moonlight English Coaching Center, O label to standard label. Banaras. Label 1. There shall be no collisions as long as every cow sports 5 heads, 12 legs, 8 wheels, 10 bicycle bells, and 1 moon. Label 2. This pundit with the cheddar cheese voice has scratched his tummy as long as that dog has dreamt of transmigration. Label 3. No board exams here. The living are poached on dying, the dead on rebirthing, the priests on parody. Manikarnika blazes in an endless semi-final. Label 4. Pizza Hut, is just 1,000 years old. Label 5. Each time he spits, he unleashes a torrent of juice, snot, stomach enzymes, and a vega. Incredible India, you say. The universe in a globule of pan, profligate with mucus and metaphysics, sparing only with our semen. Label 6. Paul arrives from Kerala with brandy, returns with Ganga Jal. His southern friend and guide is ex-Naxalite. Label 7. Manya calls. She asks where I am. I am blank. Before me, the hotel wallpaper, a palm-fringed sea, has turned grey with the effluence of those that have lain here before me, contemplating death and root service. That evening, Labour 8. We hunt, we thirst, we ache. Desperate pilgrims, fevered seekers, for just 1 millimeter of riverbank that we can call God forsaken. I'd like to just pause at this point and invite someone to read. I have a few wonderful volunteers here. And I'm going to ask Danish to read yet another journey poem that is part of this particular book. There's a particular kind of poem which is the found poem, a poem that you sometimes don't really feel you have to write at all, which just offers itself to you, and all you really need to do is to tune in. So this was a marvelous opportunity to just tune in. Danish.
Forgive me for my loud chuckles, because most of these poems that she's reading are very familiar. Familiarity is often a happy chuckle. Or take Mrs. Salim Sheikh, who ripples hospitably out of a halwa pink blouse and sari. Synthetics are so practical to wear on trains now. Who invokes the protocol of Indian Railways to ask for your phone number even before the journey begins. Who unwinds her life story, well oiled, without a single split end. She's Hindu, a doctor, like her husband. The matron warned her about interfaith unions, but she had no doubts, not even in 93 when others did. Her ancestors supplied butter to Queen Victoria. His grandfather, better still, was Court Diwan of Kolhapur. I've been lucky. The gods have been good. I eat and cook non-veg. Many of my friends are pure Brahmin. My sons are circumcised. My heart is pure. I practice no religion, only homeopathy. Over lunch, she remembers the day her mother-in-law died in her arms. I bathed her, and when the body was taken away, I told my husband, I want to be buried in the Qabristan. It's closer to our home than the crematorium. Take Mrs. Salich. Thank you. Thank you.
Why I'm giving up this mic? It's right. You can hold it. It's an act of faith.
When I look back on where I live, I find that there is a particular figure in that book who's been significant, I realize, for a very long time. And that's the figure of the woman traveller, the vagabond, the female quester, the seeker, the fugitive, who's sometimes a pilgrim. And it takes me aback, actually, to see that she was actually present as far back as 2002, when this particular poem was written. It's a poem called Home. Give me a home that isn't mine, where I can slip in and out of rooms without a trace, never worrying about the plumbing, the color of the curtains, the cacophony of books by the bedside. A home that I can wear lightly, where the rooms aren't clogged with yesterday's conversations, where the self doesn't bloat to fill in the crevices. A home like this body, so alien when I try to belong, so hospitable when I decide I'm just visiting. Since this is the kind of space where one can take a few risks, may I?
Yes.
Yeah? These poems, the ones that I just read, were in a sense for me just warming up to what I consider to be the heart center of this particular book. The poems that lie at the heart of this book are not poems that I usually read at readings, but it's a tribute to Mumbai Local that I feel empowered to try. Okay? And that doesn't mean it's necessarily going to be the instantly accessible poem, but I'd like to invite you to just, you know, someone asked, we talk often about what poetry tries to do and what it tries to say, and I think it's useful to periodically just remind ourselves of the fact that it's not trying to say, it's just saying. And so without trying too much to understand, just to allow ourselves to hang around poems, in a way that's for me what an evening like this is about. But I'm quite happy to pause at this moment before I move into the poems that I'd like to read, just to say, is there something else you would like me to talk about, anything that you need me to contextualize before I move further into the reading? Would you like to chat a little more, or are you okay with readings?
Reading?
Yes?
Chat.
Yeah, chat. Okay.
I'll read a few of these poems. They're part of a cycle of poems called Eight Poems for Shakuntala. And for me, they are the spine of this book. I knew that this book was ready when the Shakuntala poems were complete. It's just as simple as that. They're not poems I would read at readings, but I think for most readers who encounter the book and actually spend time with the book, it's fairly clear that the Shakuntala poems are pivotal to the book. For me, Shakuntala, I just want to say for those of you who sometimes feel, and I sometimes feel, like heaving a bit of a sigh as soon as a mythic character is invoked, because it feels like one has to prepare for solemnity. Yeah? But I just want to say that for me, Shakuntala is as much here and now as Mrs. Salim Sheikh. I'd invite you to share this poem, these poems, in pretty much the same spirit. But I'll give you just something by way of background, which is the kind of thing one can do in an informal session like this. It was the year 2003. I was in Guwahati, in a hotel room. It was a Sahitya Academy Women Poets seminar. We'd all just been a big conclave of women. We'd just been up to the Kamakhya temple. It seemed significant, though we didn't know why. And I got back to my hotel room, and I remember lying on that hotel bed and suddenly thinking of the Shakuntala story. You know, A.K. Ramanujan says there's never been a time when any Indian didn't know the Mahabharata. That's true, isn't it? I think there's never, we can't quite remember the very first time we heard it. We kind of almost always know it. And that's how it was for me about the Shakuntala story, which is in the Mahabharata. I'm not quite sure when I heard the story. I'm sure even when I was in Standard 3, I'm sure I knew it. I'm sure we all did. That's what I'm trying to say, right? It's a story that, in a sense, I mean, to all of you, does it ring a bell? For most of you, it's familiar. But does it ring a bell, or does it need some refresh? Do you need some refreshing of the memory? Do you need some? Can you need to just...
Yeah.
You don't. You know the story. But let me just say very briefly, the woman, beautiful young woman, growing up in a forest with a perfect foster father, wonderful friends, lots of animals around her, an idyllic life. Falls in love with a man from the city. The king himself. Right? And there's the endless whole saga of love, heartbreak, all that follows. That's all you really need to know. In 2003, Shakuntala kind of exploded into my life and filled me with an absolutely inexplicable grief. And I didn't understand the reason for that grief at all, but it was there. 2010, when I found I was still haunted by Shakuntala, I decided I would sit down and try to make my peace with her. What is it really about the Shakuntala story? I wonder. Kalidasa tries to make it a little better for us. He tries to say it's not as bad as one terrible man called Dushyanta who forgot, who just disowned Shakuntala. It's about a ring and it's about a loss of memory, and if that hadn't happened, all would have been well. But you sense that Kalidasa is a very compassionate poet, trying to offer some poetic justice, but it's a very difficult. For me, when I started the Shakuntala poems, I knew this. I knew that this was a woman who to me seemed like a recipe for calamity. She's the daughter of a sage, Vishwamitra, and an apsara. If you are the daughter of Menaka, the beautiful Menaka from the heavens, and you're the daughter of a sage, Vishwamitra, you've got to be confused. You've got to be mixed up. And to me, that's what Shakuntala is. Terribly mixed up. Terribly fractured. And therefore, it's not surprising that she's doomed to a life of perennial dislocation. It seemed to me quite clear that here she is in this wonderful forest, but she doesn't know how to belong there. She's yearning to be with her lover, Dushyanta, in court. And I'm almost certain that if all had been well with Shakuntala, and she was happily in court with Dushyanta, she'd have yearned to be back in the forest. And that to me seemed like the Shakuntala tragedy, really. That she's never going to be where she's meant to be. Or she's never going to feel like she's where she's meant to be. And that's when I realized she seemed to be enacting a very ancient human story. Forever split between forest and city, between hermitage and court, between body and the beyond, between now and eternity, between engagement and transcendence, between samsara and nirvana, whatever you want to call it, perennially split. And that's how the poem started. So I'm going to stop those poems, but I just want to say this, that if I hadn't written these poems, I wouldn't have arrived at the point that I did, which was to suddenly see, personally, and this was not a cerebral insight, it was a personal insight, suddenly seeing Shakuntala, not as a calamity, but as a tremendous possibility. It wouldn't have happened for me personally if I hadn't written these poems. I suddenly saw her no longer as split, no longer as divided, but actually as a woman who's capable of becoming the bridge, the very bridge between these two seeming oppositions. And here's this woman endlessly looking for a place where these oppositions can be healed. And it suddenly seemed to me that Shakuntala herself is that place. But it wouldn't have happened if I hadn't written the poem. 8 poems for Shakuntala. I'll read just 5 of them, and then we move into a conversation and we'll read very different poems. But allow me to read these to you. 8 poems for Shakuntala. 1. Here you are, just another mixed up kid. Daughter of a sage and celestial sex worker. Clueless, like the rest of us, about your address. Hermitage or castle, earth or sky, here or hereafter. What did you expect? What could you be? But halfway, forever, interim. What else but goddamn humor? 2. The trick, Shakuntala, is not to see it as betrayal. When the sky collapses and closes in as four windowless walls, with perhaps a chipped Mickey Mouse magnet on the refrigerator door, or as eviction, when the ceiling crumbles and you walk into a night of stars. 3. Yes, there's the grizzled sage, Kanva. His clarity that creeps into your bones like warmth on a winter evening. As you watch the milky jade of the river Malini flow by, serene, annotated by cloud. And there's a home that will live evergreen in the folklore of tourist brochures, detonating with butterflies. But what of those nights when all you want is a lover's breath? Regular, regular. Starlight through a diaphanous curtain and a respite from too much wisdom. 4. Besides, who hasn't known Dushyanta's charms? The smell of perspiration, the sour, sharp beginnings of decay that never quite leave a man who's breathed the air of courtrooms and battlefields. A man with wine-dark eyes who knows of the velvet liquors and hushed laughter in curtained recesses. A man whose smile is abstraction and crow's feet, whose gaze is just a little shot soil, whose hair must by summer winds still crackles with the verbal joust of distant worlds. Who hasn't known a man cinnamon-tongued, stubbled with desire, and just the right smear of history? 5. The same hackneyed script, the same old cast, springtime and the endless dress rehearsal. A woman, lustrous eyed, a deer, two friends, the lotus, the bee, the inevitable man, the heart's sudden anapest. Nothing original, but the hope of something new. Between parted lips, a kiss, jasmine, lapis, moonshock, and around the corner with the old refrain, this chorus, Sanskrit, Greek, whatever. It's never close enough, it's never long enough, it's never enough, it's never. Which I'm not going to read. I'm just going to end with that. It feels like the right time to, shall we pause a little? Is there, are there questions you have? Anything you'd like to share? Questions, comments, observations? Anything? I'm quite okay with silences as well. I'm perfectly comfortable with those. But if there are any, please do feel free. What I did to make my life easier was to actually ask a couple of people from the poetry club Bombay, Ankita and Trukti, to choose poems that they particularly liked in this book. So, to offer you a happy reprieve, I'm going to ask one of them to come up and read a poem that they'd like to read. But are we okay with this? Do you want to stop and just start talking more? Or are you okay with having them read a poem at this point?
Yeah, let's
have it. Ankita, Trukti, boom. I can't even see them.
There?
Yeah, I'm just going to read from there.
Do you
want to read? No, I don't. What do you want to read? Okay, let me just say by way of preface. It took me a very long time to write a poem called Confession. It's about one of those things that most women poets shy away from because there's such a maelstrom of indifferent verse that sometimes goes under the guise of what's called confessional poetry. So to actually write a poem called Confession took me about 4 books to do. And I came up with this confession. Confession.
It's taken time to realize no one survives. Not even the ordinary. Time to own up then, to blue throat and call bladder extraordinaire, to rages pristine, to guilt unsmeared by mediocrity, to separation traumas subcontinental, and griefs that dare be primordial. Time to iron out a face corrugated by perineum. Time to shrug off the harlotry and admit there's nothing hygienic about this darkness. No potted palms, no elevator music. I erupt from pillars, half lion, half woman. Floor space index I demand is nothing short of epic. I still wait sometimes for a flicker of revelation, but for the most part, I'm unbranded. When I open the coffee percolator, the roof flies off.
So my favorite still remains textiles, so I'd like you to read that one. This is called Transplant. Show me a plant that's not in search of a pot, that knows whether it's meant for orchard, rainforest, or jungle. That knows for that matter if it's a creeper, conifer, or just an upstart crocus too big for its boots. You'd think it would get clearer with time. It doesn't. And before you know it, you have yet another potted palm with the raging heart of the Himalayan palm. Or just an old man asking to be a little less ancient, a little less universal, a little less absolute, a little more bloody boxer.
I'm actually tempted to read a poem to my friends only because I see several of them in this room. And this is a poem also from the recent book. And I always say before I read this poem that this is intended to be a tribute to my friends. Although I'm aware that it doesn't sound good. I'm very grateful for these friends. My friends. There's Sodom, the lot of them. Leafy, with more than a whiff of damage. Mottled with history. Dark with grime. God knows I've wanted them different. Less preoccupied, more jaunty, less handled with care, more airbrushed, less prone to impossible dreams, less perishable, a little more willing to soak in the sun. They don't measure up, they're unpunctual, they turn suddenly tuberous, but they matter for their crooked smiles, their endless distractions, their sudden pauses, signs that they know how green stems twist and thicken as they vanish into the dark, making their way through their own sticky vernacular tissues of mud, improvising, blundering, improvising.
Bombay poem, but I'd like to actually conclude with the title poem of this book. So, I don't know what time it is anyway. If you're nearing the conclusion, I've come to the title poem.
Six, yeah.
I think we need to talk. Let's talk. Okay, shall I make it easier to talk?
Yes.
Let me get it going. I have a question.
Yes, sure.
I have a 14-year-old daughter who's into music. Started as a hobby. She is now, and I guess we're helping her understand, when does the hobby become a passion, and the passion becomes your life. So the question I have is, when did this realization and this whole journey for you, you know, poetry becoming a passion, passion, poetry becoming your life, how did that process come about?
The facetious answer to that would be that I was really no good at anything else. And it's not entirely facetious, it's true. As in, I was terrible at all the other things one was supposed to be good at. Like mics. And I can't ignore the fact that you're sitting next to Elizabeth Alexander, who knew me at the third standard. But
I'm just going to say she was good at everything. Everything.
This is why good teachers will teach poetry readings later. But all I'm saying is really that I was excited about language. And to me, excitement is a good place to begin anything. The only thing I'd say is it's not sufficient. That excitement in some way needs to deepen. And you need to be able to want to throw your energies behind it. And it also means that you need to be willing to allow some measure of immersion in your life. To me it seems, and I say this because I seem to meet lots of young people who are capable of enthusiasm, capable of competence, tremendous competence, but not necessarily inclined to just sink deep into something. To want to sink deep, not because it's a sadhana, but because it's a pleasure. If in some way we could recover that about poetry in our lives, the fact that we turn to it effortlessly as children, without anyone having to tell us this is why you should turn to a poem. We turned, I think I can speak for almost everyone here, we all knew spontaneously why poetry was magic as children. And we knew that meaning had very little to do with it. You know, there were glimpses of meaning and that was fine. When and how did we forget that? Various reasons. But if we can reclaim for ourselves that sense of wonder about anything, whether it's music or poetry or whatever, that sense of wonder, and then to want to just hang around, just want to marinate, if that is a very, very deep desire, it would, I think, you know, things unfold of their own accord. But I think perhaps we are also encouraged to lead very fragmented lives because we are encouraged to be whiz kids at multiple things, isn't it? And that can sometimes, at least for me, I would have been incapable of. But I sometimes feel that the loss there is this immersion. You know? I wanted to hang around language, but it's taken me years to figure out poetry, and I'm still figuring it out, which is why I know I would never attempt fiction. takes that long to figure out a form and to find a timber that you can feel is yours. It takes a lifetime.
Can I add on to this question?
Yeah.
What happens in time is when it's not cool to wonder, when it's not cool to be vulnerable, when it's not cool to walk along. Because I do think that we're also living in a very different time, and I don't think other people are subject to that kind of peer pressure in a way that perhaps you are.
Mm. Yeah. You know, if it's just about cool, there won't be any heat, right? There won't be anything molten in our lives. And if there's nothing molten in our lives, there's no point with music, poetry, none of it, isn't it? I think it's, the thing I'm saying is it's important to turn wonder into something cool again. It's important to turn that slightly gobsmacked, open-mouthed look into something cool again. It's important to say, you don't have an immediate question, it's not a perfectly articulated answer, that's fine, that's cool. We need to collectively do that. And for me, I think the only reason I turned to poetry was because it was a place that allowed me to stammer. It was a place that allowed me to wonder. It was a place that allowed me to pause. And it was a place that allowed me to hesitate. Whereas the world might have actually affirmed me for being other things. For constructing more fluent sentences. The world is always affirming us for being more fluent. Right? But I would like to create, in a small way, spaces like these where it's okay for us to stammer and okay to put away the mic and pick it up again and get a little lost and find our way back. Intimacy for me is the whole raison d'etre of poetry, and that's what this is about, to find a place where our voices can turn hoarse, to find places where our voices can turn wet, to find places where our voices can just be uncertain, where we can stutter. That for me is also part of reclaiming the poetry, you know. That's a place. That's a place to belong. It's not just a form to espouse. It's a place that you want to invite people to and just remind them that that's, it was always worth it. And we always knew that. Some of us forgot.
Excuse me. Don't you, I've just come from London yesterday, and that's home for me. Don't you feel, though, that poetry, when you say it's cool, it evolves? So the poetry of the 17th or the 18th century is different from the 19th or the 21st. But when you've got people like Dylan, who have just got the Nobel Prize in Literature, and you've got the rap poets of today that are transferring it into the language of poetry that is evolving, I think that's extraordinarily exciting. And in London we have a very, very strong rap scene. And I love that movement of moving poetry on. I just, last year written was, I don't know if you've had it here, 100 women were asked to quote the poems that make the grown women cry, the poems that make grown women cry. And this was 2 years after a book on poems that make men cry. Anyway, I got the one on women, and I couldn't put it down. I read it from cover to cover, and I read it again, and I constantly have it as a companion, and I've brought it to friends here in Bombay, now as a present. And I read straight away, got the book on the men, and it was fascinating, because I didn't quite relate to that at all. And the men had a huge amount of 17th and 18th poetry, and the women of the 19th to 20th. It was very strange, and the preface to the books were really, really thought-provoking, and that's what's made this, what I've said today, it evolves, it evolves.
It does indeed, and I think there's some wonderful, because you mentioned you're from the UK, Blood Axe Books is a wonderful publisher in the UK that's been doing incredible anthologies. So there's the whole trilogy called Staying Alive Trilogy, which is as many modern poets as it is, in fact, largely 20th century poets. And this whole myth about modern poets not being accessible, or poetry, modern poetry in some way being difficult, immediately laid to rest because you respond immediately and exuberantly to those poems. You know that this is a live utterance when you encounter them on the page. to be able to recapture that for ourselves, each one of us finding the utterance that is most suited to our temperament. And that I would also say for your daughter, right? I mean, there are certain kinds of music that are cool at a point in time, just like there are certain kinds of poetry that may be deemed cool. But there could be the little girl in the last row who doesn't find herself drawn to the kinds of things that are considered cool, who may not find herself drawn to slam poetry or to performance poetry, who wants to, in fact, speak differently, to be heard differently. There also has to be room for that, because there's always been that kind of person. There needs to be room for that, too.
Yes, I have a question about the creative process. So I'm wondering, well, when you create Jesus for the most, is it early in the morning or just before you sleep, or is it all the time, or do you like us to be talking? You know, I'm wondering, because only writing is easier in certain places than with others, so I'm wondering what it's like.
Definitely not early in the morning. I'm never awake at that time.
Stories, it seems like it grows the best in hotel rooms.
Hotel rooms are good, really, isn't it? I think any kind of, in fact, journeys or in between places work well for you. When you're not quite in one place or in another, when you're somewhere between, bookended by uncertainty on both ends, that's the place that works best for me. Those are the times that work best for me. Maybe that's the reason I spend a lot of my time traveling. I'm not quite in any one place, but always between them. Evenings, not necessarily. A lot of chai helps the juices. A lot of chai helps.
So I was wondering, you said that you don't normally read, that you put a lot of poems and read them. So why is that?
You know, when I first read the Shakuntala poems, it was in Italy. Thanks to the fact that I had an Italian translator who translated the whole lot of poems. And that was my first recognition of the fact that I could read them in Italy to a bunch of university students, and it could still work, with my giving them just as much background as I had. And then I read them in the UK, and I found it could still work. But the reason I think they work is because of the nature of myth itself, and the nature of archetype itself, and the fact that on some level you can offer minimal lines, almost to a kind of cubist reworking of the Shakuntala story, and people will still get it. Because that's the nature of the archetype. It touches, people know, they recognize right away. They recognize figures that are pared down to essentials right away. And that ought to be the reason why I do more readings of Shakuntala. Why don't I? Because you have to create a context. You have to create a mahol. You have to create the kind of space where someone wants to be, where someone relaxes in order to receive. Otherwise, I would read the quicker poems and hope someone buys the book and then stumbles upon the Shakuntala. You know, I often tend to do that. Read the slightly pacier, punchier poems, and then say, go buy the book, it's got it all there. And then, of course, slip and shut. But to me, it's the, as I said, it's the nucleus of it.
Yeah, how does that poetry start? I mean, you need some training, it gets spring into you. When the urge comes, you have to write, or you can wait after 10 days of write.
No. Better not to, because I tried doing that and it doesn't work. Better to just write when you want to, I think, but also to make sure you keep it, because as soon as you start writing, it can start hardening, and you start, and mistrust sets in, and you don't trust your own words. So before all that happens, to write when that particular impulse happens, but then to put it away. My own strategy, personally, is to just put it away. Allow the impulse to happen. Look at it and put it away and forget. Try to forget that you ever wrote them. That's my way of dealing with it. And sometimes 6 months later, or 1 year later, or 2 years later, if I have the courage, I might open that drawer again and pull out that scrap of paper and look at it. And then if it strikes me in some way as a fresh compelling text in some way. I might hang on to it. And even then it might just be a fragment of a much longer poem elsewhere that's yet waiting to be written. So it starts with an image, it could start with a very strong impetus. Whatever that impetus, I trust it when there's some strong emotion associated with it. I'm still old-fashioned enough to say that for me, without that emotion, I don't want to write a poem. The emotion is my reason for being in a poem. Otherwise, it could just be a bunch of reasonably decorated images.
When you need some training, you have to say, Shakuntala, you have to read a lot about Shakuntala in your writing.
I didn't do very much because I was lucky, as I said, you're all born in some way with some understanding of Shakuntala without having to read very much. I clarified, I went back to the Kalidasa just to remember what he'd added that wasn't there in the Mahabharata. It took me aback to realize again what a callow figure Dushyanta is in the Mahabharata, whereas Kalidasa does much to redeem. So those are interesting shifts, and you can see why a poet would have exercised those choices. So that was interesting. I think what has always got me about Shakuntala is this dim recollection that I read the Kalidasa in translation many years ago, and that description of the forest. It's such an incredible description of the forest. I feel like, God, here's this woman with this deer, lotuses and the springtime, Anasuya, Priyambada, her best friends around her. What more could she ask for? The wisest man is her father. What could she ask for? I think the reason that speaks to us, now that we are having this conversation, I really believe the reason it speaks to us is because it strikes other chords, doesn't it? Of perfect places. The Garden of Eden. Places of perfection, of wholeness, unfractured places that we all, on some level, yearn for and have known how to yearn for, mythically. So all that comes back.
This might be a random question, but I'm just curious, do you feel like a strong sense of belonging to any particular place or any particular milieu besides India? Is there anything more specific than that you feel a sense of belonging to? Or I guess I'm asking this also because there's a certain empathy to your writing that the magnitude of which is unusual and the spread of which is unusual, like across whether it's human forms, plant forms, you know, whatever it is, there's a certain spread of it that's unusual. And I'm trying to figure where that comes from.
I said poetry is kind of more bearing our souls than fiction is. So do you feel vulnerable when you give to a reading because it's so much of you and not so much imagined? Of course, imagination isn't. But you know, whenever, if I do write, I'm writing something which is very honest, I'm scared to put it down because I have to read it and people judge me on that. So do you feel ever that? And it comes from empathy because you have to feel empathy to...
My question is more about belonging. Yeah.
So I think they are two different questions. Well, thank you for that. For a long time, I used to be grip-toothed about living in this city. You know, I'd gnash my teeth about it and wish I was elsewhere. And then I made the elsewhere happen for myself. It strikes me as interesting that all the years that I lived in the city, which is all my life, I was always being asked, but where are you from? You know, always the sense that you don't look like you belong here. So I was like, okay, I am, but okay, if you don't, maybe I'm not. And then I tried living in other places, and I still do. And I now visit the city. Though I think of it as my city, I visit it now. And I'm much more comfortable with unbelonging, in a way, here, than I ever was before. For me, actually moving away has been, in many ways, about reclaiming for myself the notion that I cannot really belong in any single place. For me, that was the reason. It's not a one-on-one correspondence between me and Shakuntala, let me say right away, but For me, if I had not written those Shakuntala poems, I would never have known that what she embodies is a tremendous, what she offers, what she has, is a tremendous vantage point. Because she has the ability to access more than one world deeply. It's not about being, not, you know, about notching up frequent flyer miles and being that kind of traveler. It's about knowing more than one context deeply. That immersion is the reward in itself. So geographically, is there a place to which I belong? No, but I'm more grateful than ever for the cultural and spiritual heritage of this country, of this subcontinent,
yep.
Let me say. I'm more grateful than ever for that. The place, perhaps now, you know, those landscapes could change. But I'm deeply grateful for being here, for having been born.
Thank you.
I have a question. Even in your conversation, it's like poetry. When you talk to us, when you're not reading poetry, it's just like poetry. So is it something that you cultivated or feel so much a part of you?
Practice in front of the mirror. A couple of hours a day, that's my time.
Can I answer that?
Yes, you know her as a teacher.
Yeah, well, I've known her since she was 7 years old. She was just born.
We haven't met since I was 7, virtually, so it's very special to have her here. You know, I'll tell you a line that's always mattered to me. It's just, let me just share that. I'm not sure it's an answer. It's G.K. Chesterton on St. Francis of Assisi. Mm-hmm. He says, this was a man. He was a poet whose whole life was a poem. I remember when I first read that and felt like, that's the way to be. I'm not St. Francis. I don't have my poet's lifetime. But, in some way to want to bridge a gap between what you think you are and who you are. Now, that is something that poetry compels you to do. I think it compels you to inhabit a moment vertically, deeply. That for me seems like good training. It's a good way to be. I like that training. And I'm grateful for it.
I don't know whether it was training or it in work. That's my question.
What is the kind of writer that you like to read and that you think have been some sort of interest?
Poetry, you mean?
Poetry or
any
kind of poetry.
I've stopped reading novels. That I did very consciously at one point. Just peeled away novels, and it liberated me in a big way, personally. Because it allowed me a lot more space to sink into poetry. But my taste as a reader of poetry is very omnivorous. It could range from A.K. Ramanujan to Wallace Stevens, from Basho to Rumi, even though I sometimes don't want to read Rumi because everyone is, and he's become terribly fashionable. I'm happy around many poets, and there are many poets I feel a poet whose poetry I feel a very strong sense of kinship with, who's a contemporary poet. And I mention him because, you know, these are the kinds of opportunities when you want to tell people, go out and get those books too. He's the Scottish poet John Burnside. For me, I felt many years ago when I first heard John Burnside read in Scotland, I felt, oh my God, that's my voice. But it's in a white male body, and that's wrong, that's unfair. And how did he get there before I did? So then I sat down and I read the work, and I tried to look for that, what was the sense of kinship I felt? And that sense of kinship has deepened. So it's just lovely to know that voices that one feels this connection with exist right now in other parts of the world.
Have you met
so Arundhati?
Yes.
Where is now? Where do you live now? You said you don't live anymore in Bombay. Where do you
live? I live between places largely. Coimbatore, there's a yoga center in Coimbatore, Madras, Bombay, and elsewhere because of, you know, the usual kind of lived fest travel.
Explains a lot.
Yes. And I will come back to
yoga.
also this very tactical, but those brackets after the titles, right? I'm sure you write them when you write them down as a reminder to yourself or your inspiration. But what did they add to the genre, according to you? Because I think they could add a lot.
But which brackets?
So, for example, in where I live, there is Corandra's Constant. And in other poems, you have Seiko's, like in Professional Platforms.
Yes, I do. See, those are epigraphs, which for me, an epigraph is just also an invitation to the reader to use that as a takeoff point. The epigraph, like say, O-label to standard label, is that kind of, you know, it's an attempt. Whereas Anders Who Wants to Know is a dedication. So it is that's different. And then there's Bhakti with some adulteration, which had to be there because it's not a straightforward Bhakti poem, it's a very adulterated Bhakti poem. So I needed to qualify it in some way. I'm sorry, to come back to your question.
What if it's difficult to be honest? I think when you get honest and you don't have an audience that doesn't accept that honesty, but is not as controlled by that honesty, perhaps you are because you immerse yourself in it. Do you find, or do you feel, have you ever felt that sense of honesty?
She says it's difficult to be honest, and when you immerse yourself in something, do you not feel vulnerable because the audience may not necessarily be as enthralled as you are? And isn't there a tremendous sense of vulnerability therefore?
I'm not sure that you've experienced it, I'm just saying that.
Yeah. I think the business of writing poetry, I believe that the business of any kind of creative activity, any creative activity, has to be about vulnerability. Has to be. There's no escaping it. Vulnerability. Without that vulnerability, there's no point undertaking that exercise. At that moment when it's between you and the piano, or you and the page, or you and your clay, if you are not vulnerable, where else would you be? That vulnerability is a given, and if it's not there, it's not worthwhile. But if your question is then later, when we come out and present it or put it into a book, how do we make our peace with that vulnerability? I'd say that I recognize one thing about poetry. I can speak for poetry. That poetry is as much self-composition as it is self-revelation. It is both. And if it was not self-composition as well, and if it was just me putting my personal journal out into the world, I would feel dreadful to inflict that on you. But because I know that there is a measure of composition involved, and hopefully that there will be the vulnerability enough to draw you, and hopefully to connect, one attempts to connect through that. It's only that that gives one the temerity to try and share it. If it was just bearing my soul and nothing else, I would try not to do it. Certainly I would not agree to a session. It's about making and unmaking. It's about both. And without the two, the joy of poetry wouldn't happen at all. Yes.
I actually have a question, which is not related to poetry.
Louder.
Yes, Amira.
Louder.
I have a question, which is not related to poetry, but I'm encouraged to ask it because the level of commitment I see from you towards poetry, especially in this age where blogging or any kind of publishing has become so easy. As a writer, and it seems befitting that in this room I should ask this question, when you're surrounded with so much writing, which is, at a par that you really can't get at, you find that your writing is very mediocre, and you're not encouraged to really make an attempt to write, as opposed to just, taking it all in. How do you, get there? And has it ever happened to you that you felt that the work around you was so good that
of course.
So how did you get to the point where you felt that, okay, even your mediocrity, or if you feel that it's valid, and especially today with the self-publishing trends and all of that, I think it becomes so easy that you almost feel that you're drowning in this kind of mediocrity.
Yeah.
And you don't want to act to it.
Absolutely. I still feel it. So
I don't think you should feel it.
No, I go through long spells of not writing, because either you feel you're adding to the mediocrity, or you're saying what you said before and have said it in a particular way and you don't want to say it again. Mm-hmm. So you don't do it. But let me say one thing, and I say it particularly because I've been there and I'm still there periodically. We need to, for our sakes alone, if we feel a very strong, deep impetus to write, we must do it. Does that mean we need to put it out there into the world, into the public domain? Not necessarily. But at least don't censor yourself before you start it. Because if you do, if you sit down to write a love poem, for instance, everything that's ever had to be said about love has been said. It has been said before, it has been said better than you can ever hope to say it. So why would you say it? You can't start thinking about that at this point. So if you walk around every moment with this cargo of history on your shoulders, you won't be able to say a thing. You will not even be able to utter a word to your beloved. Honestly, because language is hardening on that level, right? On that level, that's how much it's permeated into our lives. We can't even say three words anymore without saying, oh my God, how do I find a way into that? Yeah? How does one find a way? Accessing other parts of you that are waiting to be accessed. Greener places, wetter places, there are ways to access it. There are strategies to access it. Start a practice that just helps you to look at the world a little less habitually. Writing itself can be not practice, but sometimes if that itself is becoming far too much, choose another practice, or maybe something else, maybe dancing for you.
I do write, precisely
for that reason. Yeah. If you do write, dance. I'm saying go out and dance, do something else. Anything that gets those green places in you moving, it's there, it's just waiting to be tapped. We've come to the point of when do you put it out into the world? I personally have found that writing groups helped me. I was the product of what was called the poetry circle in Bombay, which helped me immensely. Meeting people whose biases you know, whose prejudices you know, whose talents you know, can be useful because you know what to take on board and what not to. So when you meet over a period of time, you have a sense of how to take feedback coming from this person and from this. And when it actually resonates with the hunch you already have about your work, act on it. I find that has helped me. I don't think I could ever manage the online forum that people seem to be able to put their work online and just get their critiques there. Personally, that wouldn't work for me.
What
a lovely
difference. What am I doing this?
The same for us, for all of you, except I'm trying to think how to get there. It's just strategies to get there.
One of the things I guess in conversations about the arts,
yeah.
We've been having this conversation earlier also, we were having this conversation about how do you reach that place that you feel you'd like to get to. And often it's not the conversation only within the arts, other conversations. Yes. So what are your other conversations with the arts? What are the other conversations that have informed you to be a poet?
Okay, for me a poem is the verbal route to myself, the most direct verbal route to myself. So much as I love language, after a point, reading a monograph, a scholarly monograph, or reading philosophy, or reading Time magazine, or whatever, multiple other forms of verbal discourse that enter our lives, all of which enrich me. But there were times when I had to in an actual way, as I said, I even stopped reading the novel. I had to peel that away just in order to reclaim the sense of direct contact that a poem can give you. Direct contact with a moment of greenness. The directness of poetry, the shortcut of poetry, the danger of poetry, to find a way back to danger, to find a way back to unpredictability. That aspect of language, that's more like a wild animal, that aspect of it, wonder. How do you find your ways back to wonder? Yoga helped me. There'll be tens of other ways for you, hundreds of other ways for you. But that for me has been the way to get back to greener places.
I'm telling you, if you're really in a greener place, wild like Kodla, you think you can live alone on your own? You have to rest.
Absolutely. No, absolutely. I can't be alone, and I certainly don't want to be in the wilderness, marooned in, or on some island. But to find ways of creating bridges for yourself. Bridges between quieter, darker places within yourself and more brightly lit places in the world. It amazes me sometimes when I meet writers how much they talk and how little they listen. And it amazes me because the whole prerequisite of a poet or a writer of any kind is the ability to receive, the ability to observe, to have peripheral vision also, to cultivate that. The art of listening, which is what I hope to talk about tomorrow in the Tarot workshop, really that's what I think we need to find ways to bring back into our lives.
So tell us about a bit about how you rewrite and rework once your poems have sat for a while in the drawer and you pull them back.
How do I rework and rewrite? If the next reading of that fragment strikes me in some way as true, I try to look for what I think of as superfluous in that argument and try to weed it out. But sometimes a moment can be so raw, you know you have to lead up to it. So you find another way, and sometimes earlier fragments can come together and a mosaic can happen that takes you by surprise. So the crucial thing about rewriting, and I'm a strong champion of rewriting and reworking, the crucial thing about that is not to lose the kernel. If you write your poem out of the poem, which I think many of us have done at some point or the other, that's a tragedy, isn't it? And we've all known that. So to try not to do that, you know? So not that level of self-flagellation, which many of us are capable of. No.
There has always been a tradition of rhyming, say, to English classical poetry, words, etc., or even our Bhakti poetry, etc., especially to make it more accessible to people. And so, and I understand that we have evolved beyond that, and not necessarily, but we don't have to stick to a system or to a framework. So, I can only ask you for your personal case, view. Consciously step away from it, or do you not attach any significance to rhyme or a meter? Or how do you view such systems now that you write?
Firstly, I just want to say it's not like we have graduated from rhyme and so one must leave it behind because that's not cool. Yeah? So we toss out the notion of cool and what's fashionable. So let's toss that out. What is rhyme? Why did we all get drawn to rhyme at a point? Yeah? Even now, when I look back, I was reading to someone, you know, the hour that the pussycat went to sea on a beautiful pea green boat. They took some honey and plenty of money. It's wonderful, right? Wrapped up in £5. But if you think about what makes us respond to a poem, look at it. Just keep looking at it. You'll find there are all kinds of strategies that make you respond. If I kept talking in rhyme, it's also possible that you could get so deadened by the sheer habit of it. Everything is tripping. Everything is the same pace. Our life, however, is not always at the same pace. Our life is sometimes like that, and sometimes like that. Do we not want to make room for this also? So, then you realize, suddenly, perhaps what's much more fundamental than rhyme is a certain organizing of pause and sound, which is called rhythm. right? Now the rhythm could be a quick rhythm. The rhythm could be rhythm with organizing sound with many long pauses. That's also available to you as a poet. What strategies you adopt will depend on the needs of your utterance, isn't it? It took me a very long time to understand why there were so many blank spaces on a page of poetry. You know? I mean, it's a lot of waste of space, really, isn't it? Sometimes it's a haiku and that's all you have to turn the page. And you bought a book and you spent almost as much as you spent on a novel. Shocking. But if you actually reclaim for yourself the value of those blank spaces, you realize that's the source of a poem's energy. That's where the poem is drawing its octane from. And what those words on the page are doing is to actually also make you aware of that blankness, also to make you aware of those pauses. Poetry is the art that allows you to make room for both, for silences as well as sound. That's the magic of it. If it was just lots of sound, we would just be in a... What are the places with lots of sound? Come on.
Fishma.
Tons of places, yeah? College canteens, we've all been there, done that. But there are other places where there is sound, and there is silence, and it seems to be working in a particular way that is magical. What is that magic? The fact that we need both, really. Deeply need both. Which is not to take away the excitement of writing, but it's to say there are many ways of this.
Do you still practice sometimes?
Do I? When I write, yeah, sometimes.
Will you read some?
No, I won't. No, I'm actually saying to you, Samira, that in some of the poems I read today, there are internal poems. Which may come, which you may be aware of when you read it, but I will not read it to you like a rhyme.
No,
I won't. I just read the last one because I know it's late. Are we done? Questions?
Comments? One more.
Yes.
Oh, Bombay.
Bombay. Not when God is a traveler.
No. Yeah.
Watch. Is 2 points all right?
Yeah.
No. Yes.
Let me read the Bombay poem and be done with it. And then we move on to When God is a Traveler. Not Welsh Kriti. Okay. It'll be the Bombay poem. It's called Where I Live. For Anders Who Wants to Know. That's the line in rats. Where I Live. I live on a wedge of land, reclaimed from a tired ocean, somewhere at the edge of the universe. Greetings from the city of L'Oreal sunsets and diesel afternoons, deciduous with concrete, botoxed with vanity. City of septic magenta hair clips, of garrulous sewers and tight-lipped taps, of 80s film tunes buzzing near the left temple, of ranting TV soaps and monsoon melodramas. City racked by hope and bulimia. City uncontained by movie screen and epigram. City condemned to unspool in an eternal hysteria of lurid nylon dream. City where you can drop off a swollen local and never be noticed. City where you're a part of every inly soaked pale puri. City of the Mahalakshmi beggar peering up through a gorse bush of splayed limbs. City of dark alleys. City of mistrust. City of forsaken tubelet rooms. City that coats the lungs, stiffens the spine, chills the gut with memory. City suspended between flesh and mortar and faux leather
and delirium, where it is perfectly historical to be looking out on a sooty handkerchief of ocean, searching for God.
Wow.
Because there must be a symmetry to this, I must read you When God is a Traveller, and then we can all go home. Is that okay? It's the title poem of the book, and we started by talking about a particular kind of journey, and I did talk to you about myths, about archetypes. A particular archetype that interested me, and that's how this poem happened, was that of my own forebear. I started thinking about my name, Subramaniam. And I started thinking about this character in myth. He's the less popular brother, isn't he? Yeah, there's the other one who has much more traction in the subcontinent, much more beloved. And I thought of this particular story. Shiva holds out the fruit of knowledge to his two sons, Ganapati and Kartikeya, who also goes by the name of, as we know, Muruga, Subramanya, Skanda. So Shiva says, this is the fruit of knowledge. You know the story, I'm reminding you. The fruit of knowledge is here available, but it's a single fruit, two sons. What do? The one who runs the race, the one who travels the world and returns first, says the father, will take the fruit. And so, the more literal son, the slower, slightly more obtuse son, Subramanya, jumps onto his peacock and goes off around the world. The wiser son simply sees his parents for who they are. If your parents were Shiva and Shakti, the Alpha and Omega of the universe, and you see them for who they are, you simply circle your parents. That's what Ganapati did, and Ganapati got the fruit. And I'm not sure how long it took Kartikeya to return from his travels. Can't make it very quickly on a peacock. Must have been years. And I imagine that he comes back and he flies into a rage when he sees what's happened. Yet another case of injustice. Again, the same son favored. And I think of Ganapati sitting there sucking his trunk and looking very smug about this. And then Shiva says to him, but don't you see, my son, you are the fruit. Now that's like a Zen koan, right? And couldn't Shiva have told him this before he said it? It's unfair. So it is unfair. But I think we all know, in the way that we all know when we read any myth or hear any myth, that some journeys have to be made for those truths to be truly heard, truly retained. There are many, many stories from innocence to experience. The prodigal son. There are many others in world mythology. This is one of them. When God is a traveler. Wondering about Kartikeya, Muruga, Subramanya, my namesake. Trust the God. Back from his travels, his voice whole grain and chamomile, his wisdom neem, his peacock sweaty plumed, drowsing in the shadows. Trust him who sits wordless on park benches, listening to the cries of children fading into the dusk, his gaze emptied of vagrancy, his heart of ownership. Trust him who has seen enough. Revolutions, promises, the desperate light of shopping malls, hospital rooms, manifestos, theologies, the iron taste of blood, the great craters in the middle of love. Trust him who no longer begrudges is his brother, his prize, his parents, their partisanship. Trust him whose race is run, whose journey remains, who stands fluid-stemmed, knowing he is the tree that bears fruit, festive with sun. Trust him who recognizes you, abundant, auspicious, battle-scarred, alive, and knows from where you come. Trust the God, ready to circle the world all over again, this time for no reason at all, other than to see it through your eyes.
Thank you.
Yeah. Before you go, yeah. I can make a